You've had an opportunity now to read through the basics of machine learning. Now, what we're going to do in this notebook is have a look at one machine learning technique, one algorithm called the k-nearest neighbors algorithm. Now, it's very useful because it's easy to understand, and that gives us the opportunity to learn some of the basic steps that we always go through when we use machine learning in our research. Notebook 13, machine learning using the k-nearest neighbors algorithm. Really, as I've mentioned, one of the easier algorithms, and we're going to use it just to showcase all the steps that we have to go through when we design a machine learning solutions to our problems. So one thing about machine learning, it uses some of the same subjects and objects that we have in statistics, for instance, but as with many fields, it just changes the names slightly. So as we're in statistics, we would have the term independent variables. You can see here we refer to those as feature variables, or simply just the features. And those are going to be used to predict a dependent variable. And in this case, we refer to them as target variables or outcome variables. And if these target variables are categorical in nature, then we refer to all the sample space elements as classes. So just some terminology there for you to get used to. So let's import NumPy, and then from pandas we'll import some specific functions. And now scikit-learn. Now scikit-learn is a package in Python, a very important package used quite considerably in the world of machine learning. And we're going to make use of the k-nearest neighbors classifier and the k-nearest neighbors regressor. And then also some metrics and scaling. And we'll see all of those used when we go through this notebook. Of course, for plotting, we'll use our good old friend Plotly. And we're going to use some other plots as well. So let's just do matplotlib and seaborn there as well. So two more plotting libraries. In case this is run on a MacBook with a Retina display, we'll have our magic command there. And also just to showcase tables nicely, you're familiar with all of these functions now. And we're also going to work with a data set, and that is saved on Google Drive. So we'll import the drive function there. So in machine learning, as far as supervised machine learning is concerned, the two basic type of problems, a classification problem and a regression problem. In a classification problem, our target variable, our dependent variable, will be categorical in nature. So what we're going to do here is just to generate some data, and we'll put that inside of a data frame. Now, when it comes to nearest neighbors, the term nearest would infer, suggest that we're talking about some distance, and that's exactly what it is. We're talking about how far different observations, subjects, the rows in your data set, how far each of them are from each other. So we have to invent some way of measuring distance. And the most common distance we all know about is called the Euclidean distance. That's just the distance on a flat surface, how far two points are from each other. And how far they are from each other, remember, we always express that as a positive value, just the distance between two points. And so let's generate some data. So we're just seeding the pseudorandom number generator there, and we're using the rand integer. So we're just going to take random integers on this interval from 10 to 20, and we want 7 of them. That's going to be our feature column, and our target column, it's going to be a random choice between these two categorical classes, A and B. So we'd refer to them as classes, and you can see the data frame here. So we have a features column and a target column. The features are numerical values, and the target there, it's a binary classification problem. Classification, in as much as this is a categorical variable that we're going to try and predict given these input values. So let's plot these out. And we're using just the figure object here from Plotly. So there we go. We can see for our two classes, A and B, we can see the feature variable. Now this would be like a one-dimensional problem, as much as all our feature, we only have a single feature variable, so we can plot that all on a line. And when we think about the distance between these points, it's very easy for us as human beings. I mean, we just subtract the one value from the other value, and we take the absolute value. Remember, taking the absolute value makes any negative value a positive value. So for instance, if we look at the points, the values here, 12 and 19, this is 12 minus 19. That's the Euclidean distance between them. So 12 minus 19, as you can see here, so we're just using this equation here. 12 minus 19 is minus 7, and because it's absolute values, that's just the mathematical notation for that, these vertical lines, that's just equal 7. Because distance, as human beings, we always see distance as positive, not as negative values. And that's as simple as that. So let's introduce an unknown value into our data set, and that value, for as far as the feature variable is concerned, would be 12.5. So if we plot that out, we see this 12.5, and we want to know, does, you know, can the machine learning model predict whether this observation will be in class A or class B? And what k nearest neighbors does, it just does what it says on the label. It's just going to see what the distance is between some of these points. And the k in k nearest neighbors refers to the fact that we want to know how many of the nearest ones are we interested in. And that k will usually always choose as an odd number. And you'll soon see why. So let's choose k equals 3. And visually, it's quite easy to see that there'll be a class B, that's the red dots. Second nearest will be a class A, and the third nearest would be a class B. All these other points are further away. So there's the absolute value for these feature values 12, 13, and 14, as far as our new value 12.5 is concerned. And you see we do the subtractions there and express the absolute value of them. And because there's an odd number, there's always going to be a majority class. So this is all about majority voting. So we see two red dots, these three nearest ones, two red dots and one blue. So B is the majority, is in the majority of the nearest neighbors. And what the k nearest neighbors now would certainly simply do is to say that, well, two-thirds, 66.67% of cases are from class B, and only 33.33 or 34% would be from class A, as far as my three nearest neighbors are concerned. So it'll put a probability of those, and the highest probability wins. I mean, 66.67% or two-thirds of the cases would be as far as the nearest neighbors are concerned, and our model is going to predict that this class or this new observation, this new subject in our data set that it has never seen before, our model is going to predict that this would be class B. So it's really as simple as that. Now let's bring in just a second variable. So I'm going to call that feature 2 for our second feature variable. Also random integer between 10 and 200, 100 and 200, and we divide by 7. So in the end, it's going to be between 10 and 20 with one decimal value. So let's look at our data frame now. And now we see we've got the feature, a target, but we've added a second feature. So now we're living on not on a straight line anymore, as far as each observation now has two variables, two feature variables. So if we plot that out, that's going to be a plot in the plane. So let's have a look at these. And there they all are, the two classes. And they each now have two feature variables. And so how would we now determine the distance between any two points? Well, we just use the Pythagorean theorem. If you think a right angle triangle, you just sum the squares of the two values. And once you have that sum, you take the square root, and that's the length of the hypotenuse. And because we're talking about distance, remember the square root of 9 is plus and minus 3, because negative 3 squared is 9 and positive 3 squared is also 9. But we're not interested when it comes to distance in the negative, so only the positive value. And you can see equation 2 there, because we square the difference between the two sides of that right angle triangle, we'll always have a positive, either 0 or positive, under the square root sign. So we can just take, as far as real numbers are concerned, the square root of that. So that works out for us. So let's put in a new observation for feature, it's feature 1 variable, or just this feature variable value will be 14, and feature 2 will be 18. And we plot it there, our little green friend there, our new subject, and we want to know, using a k-nearest neighbors algorithm, you know, which ones are the closest. We'll choose an odd number, and the majority class is going to win. Now, we can just eyeball this in these two dimensions, and we know it's going to be group B again, or class B, because these are the three nearest points, and that's all we have to do. We have to work out this little distance, this q distance here, and that distance there. It'll work out, the algorithm will work out the distances between more, but we're looking for the three nearest ones. We can actually create a little Python function, a user-defined function. And I just want to remind you here how to do that. So the keyword is def for definition. We give our name for our new function, and I'm going to call it dist_2d. And then we set the bunch of arguments that we will have to pass to the function. And there'll be 1, 2, 3, 4 values. And it's x1, y1, and you can imagine that's the coordinates of a point. So that's going to be feature variable 1's value and feature variable 2's value for that observation, and then for the second observation. And if we just use our equation there for the Pythagorean theorem, it's going to be x1 minus x2 squared and y1 minus y2 squared, and it's going to return this variable internal to our, or local to our function called distance. So we have it there. So let's have a look at those two points. My first point was 14, 18, so for that observation, for feature, the feature variable, it had a value of 14, and for feature 2, it had 18. And our new value that we've plotted there, as you can see, well, let's do that, is 14, 17.1 is the one point, 12 and 18.2 is the third one, and 13, 19.2 is the third one. What we want to know is the 14, 18. So you're going to pass that 14, 18, and one of the points was 14, 17, 1. So it'll, our little user-defined function is just going to give us the Euclidean distance between those two points, and those two points. And again, all the others are going to be further away. And what we're going to do is majority vote, or the highest probability. So 2/3 were from group B and 1/3 was from group A. So the majority class is going to win. So let's ramp things up a bit, because it's still very easy in two dimensions. But what if we have a data problem that has many feature variables? We can't plot anything more than three dimensions. It's just impossible for human beings to visualize something that's in 50 dimensions or even more. So what we're going to do here is just use the make classification function. Remember, that's in the datasets module of scikit-learn, the scikit-learn package. And we imported that, and it returns two objects for us. It's going to return a matrix X and a vector Y. The matrix X is just a spreadsheet, rows and columns of our feature variables. So each column is going to be one of the features, and every row is going to be an observation. And then the Y is going to be zeros and ones. That is just going to be a class. It's a classification problem, so there's going to be two classes, one and two, and we set that by setting up all of these arguments. So this is just a simulated data set that we can use the make classifications function to do for us. So the number of samples that we want is 200, so 200 observations, 200 rows. The number of features, 5, and we can set the number of informative, n_informative, 3. So only 3 of the variables are really going to aid any model in determining what the outcome has got to be, or what the target variable value has got to be. So there are 2 redundant ones. The number of classes that we want in our targets, only 2 classes, so binary classification problem. And we want to flip 10% of them at random to be the opposite class. So you can always make your problem, the model that you're trying to simulate here, the data that you're trying to simulate for your model, you can make it much more complicated by just increasing that flip Y, and it'll become much more difficult for your model to find the truth. And because we all want the same results, I'm just setting the random underscore state variable there to 42. So that's going to create 2 values for us, or 2 objects for us. The type of X, remember, that's going to be a multidimensional array. So bunch of columns, bunch of rows, and we can use the shape attribute just to see there. So we have 200 observations and 5 variables for each. This is now not a data frame, remember, it's just a NumPy array, so we don't have column header names, but it's, you can just see it as the values in the spreadsheet, just stripping away that first row that contains all the column headers or the variable names. And they're all 64-bit floating point values, so decimal values. The type of Y is also a NumPy array, but the shape is only going to be a single column. So you'll just see the 200, nothing. So it's a vector just of those values. So if it was in a spreadsheet, we'd have to take that column out. That becomes the thing that we're trying to predict. And the type there would be an integer, because it's just going to be zeros and ones. So let's build this into a data frame. So we're going to pass X and then have the columns feature 1, feature 2, feature 3, up to feature 5. And then we're going to add a brand new column called target, and that's going to be Y. And then we're just going to just make sure that Pandas understands that this is a categorical variable. So I'm going to add another column, and that's going to be target class, which is also Y. but I use a series, I assign to that a series object with my column of Y values, but I set the D type to be a category. So it knows that the zeros and ones are just encoding for some nominal categorical variable. And then we can look at the first five rows just using indexing there. So feature 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, my target, which in this instance is going to be just numbers, but yeah, I'm just making sure that pandas understands that this is actually a class, a classification of a categorical variable. So let's have a look at just descriptive statistics of all of these features, and we can see the mean and standard deviation of how scikit-learn's make underscore classification, how it did that. We also have to look at, you can look at the correlation between each of these. Remember, two of them were redundant. We won't know which one it is. So a scatter plot matrix will just make pairs of all our numerical variables, and it'll show if we can see what the correlation there is. And if we look here at feature 2 and feature 5 for both classes, see the target class 0 and 1 there. There seems to be a good correlation between those. Here as well in 3 and 4. So there's definitely some correlation there, but some others like 1 and 3, it doesn't seem to be any correlation there. So now we're going to, you know, build a real model. So first of all, we have this k-nearest classifier class in scikit-learn, and we have to instantiate that. That is computer language speak for, we create an instance of it. So we instantiate it, and there's a bunch of parameters that we can set. We'll leave all of them at the default values except for the number of neighbors. We have to specify what the k in our k-nearest neighbors is, and this time we'll set 5. Please check out the 5 nearest neighbors for us. And we're going to assign that to the computer variable nigh, N-E-I-G-H, short for neighbors. And then it's a very simple thing to do. We're going to use the fit method. So now that we have an instance of this classifier, N-E-I-G-H, nigh for neighbors, dot fit. We just simply use the dot fit method, and we pass our feature variables and our target vector. And that's all it does. And there we go. We now have a model. A model has been built, and you'll see the values that were given to all these arguments that we left at the default values. The algorithm is set to auto, and that's how it sifts through all these distances. And it uses some tree, it builds some tree for that, and there's a leaf size to that. The metric is Minkowski, and that metric refers to how the distance is measured. And a Minkowski distance, if we can call it that, with a p is 2, that's just the Euclidean distance. So you get p equals 1, and p equals 3, etc. It goes up, but 2 would just be simple Euclidean distance. And the way that it searches for this, the weights will just leave, that's just left at uniform. So when you look this up on the scikit-learn website, you can learn all about these, what these arguments do. So let's create a brand new observation. So our model is now trained, and we want to bring in a brand new subject, and we want to know what the prediction would be. What would our model predict this new observation to be? So we're just going to use the randn function from NumPy. And because it is a single observation, what you will see is when you build these, invariably you get the dimensions wrong of these new observations that you want to bring into your model, to use your model to predict an outcome. But the error messages are usually, they're very clear, and they'll tell you, remember, you're only passing information about a single new object here, or subject, or observation. Please reshape it 1, -1. So it's very useful. It's very informative, the error messages. And then we've got our trained model now here, naive for neighbors, and now we'll just use the dot predict method. And this unknown observation, we pass those 5 values, 5 feature variable values to it. And it'll predict for us what it thinks it would be. And it predicts that this brand new subject of ours, according to the model that's been built, our machine learning model, it predicts that this new observation will belong to class 1 as opposed to class 0. And we can also use the predict underscore proba. And that's the probability that it has assigned to this being in this class. And we see For the class 0 is predicted a 0% probability, and for class 1 a 100% probability. And that's going to mean that the five neighbors closest to this point, well, they were all of class 1. As simple as that. So let's ramp it up from now. We understand a little bit more, and we must build up one of the next steps that we always do in the machine learning, and that's to split our data. Up till now, we've just plonked all our data. What a lovely word, plonked. We plonked all our data into, for instance, when we build linear regression. All our data, all our observations just goes into those kind of models. Not so much in machine learning. We actually split our data. We randomly take out some of the observations and we keep them separate from the model so that the model never sees them. So when we get to more sophisticated things like random forests or deep neural networks, it becomes very, very important. You want to take some of your data out of the ability for your model to learn from, because machine learning learns from your data. But you want to keep some of the data totally separate that the model's never seen, because we'll use them then after the model has trained, and we'll test our knowledge, test how good the model does against that unseen data. And because this is a supervised learning situation, we know what the outcome is going to be from those that we take out randomly, and we can measure how accurate, how correct our model was based on this unseen data. So we call that data splitting. So we're going to create two data sets. One is called a training set and the other one's called a test set. So you can see in bold there, training set and a test set. So any machine learning model is only going to learn from the training set. We then use the test set to check on the performance of our model, because we have to somehow gauge and express to others how well our model is doing, because invariably for these machine learning models, we want to deploy them in the wild and we want them to be accurate. A self-driving car has got to be pretty accurate when it drives. Models that predict diagnosis on an x-ray has to be very accurate, and we've got to express to possible users of our model how accurate we think or how well that performs. And there's certain metrics that we're going to learn about. So it helps us to introduce these two terms that you'll see quite often, and that's variance and bias. And that's always this balancing act that we have to do when it comes to machine learning models. We want this balance between variance and bias. Before, we used to refer to this as the variance-bias trade-off, but that term is not so common anymore. But we need this balance between variance and bias. So what is variance? A model with high variance really does well on the training set. And you have this problem where the model actually memorizes the training set, and it will do very well on the training set, but as soon as you show it real world data or data outside of its training environment, it's going to do very poorly on that. So we also use the term it overfits the training data, and that can be quite bad. And sometimes we need to pare back, make our models simpler, so that it makes more mistakes on the training set, because that usually or can mean that it generalizes better to unseen data. And then the opposite is the biased. When we have high bias, it does rather poorly on the training data. And depending on what the actual values are, there's certain times that we would call a model a high variance model that overfits, or that there's a high bias. The next term that you'll see there is hyperparameters. Now, hyperparameters, as far as machine learning is concerned, are the values that we choose as human beings. We have to choose those values in the design. So for k nearest neighbors, it's very simple. The k we have to decide on, we can do 3, 5, 7, or even more. That would be referred to as a hyperparameter. And all the other things, all the other arguments that are built into these classes in scikit-learn, those are all hyperparameters that we have to set. So whenever it is something that comes up in the design of a deep neural network, a random forest, a machine, a k-nearest neighbors machine learning model, all the things that we set at design time, those are called hyperparameters. What the machine learning model tries to learn in more sophisticated modeling than k-nearest neighbors are the parameters. It has to learn parameters, and with those parameters, it makes a prediction. But the things we set as a hyperparameter. So let's do the strain test split. And I suppose that's another kind of hyperparameter, because we have to decide how much data do we want to randomly pluck out of our complete data set. And that really depends on how much data we have. Here we have only 200 rows. What you want to do is take away enough. It's another balancing act. You want to take away enough so that this set that you're going to train gives a fair indication of how good this model really is. The problem is the more you take out, the less data there is for machine learning model to train. And machine learning models are very hungry when it comes to data. The more data you can feed it during the training phase, the more, you know, the chance you improve the chances of this being an accurate model. So it's something you really have to sit and think about. You also don't want unbalanced classes, and we'll have a look at that. So let's just use this train test split function in scikit-learn. And what you pass to it is your set of feature variables and your target vector. And you set a test size. So in this instance, I've said I want 20% of the data split taken off at random. And what the train test split function does, it returns four different objects. And we have to just assign names to them. So very commonly you'll see x underscore train and x underscore set. So that will be the training set's feature variables and the test set's feature variables. And then y underscore train and y underscore test, as the name suggests, there's the descriptive names that we've chosen. That will be the training set and the test set's target variables. And we set the test size to 0.2, as I said, and then random underscore state, so that if you run the code, you're going to get the same pseudo-random split to your data. Now, as I said, we have to talk about unbalanced classes. So you might have a problem where you deal with data and one of your classes is just most of your observations are of that one class, and that'll be unbalanced data. So you just have to make sure in your training set and in your test set, as far as the target variable is concerned, that there's not too big an imbalance. So let's use the NumPy unique function. We do yTrain and we return underscore counts. We set that to true because with that unique function, it says, well, I found two classes, 0 and a 1, and there were 83 and 77 of the two respectively. So quite close to each other, that's not a big problem. What you have to do is make sure in the test set that you have a fair representation of all the classes. And that is also why it's important to take enough data as far as your test set is concerned so that you don't have class imbalance. And we see 18 and 22 there. So that is a fairly, you know, equal distribution there. So not a problem for us in this toy model. Now we set our hyperparameter, and that is k, and we want k equals 5. So let's instantiate another k nearest neighbors classifier using the k neighbors classifier class there. We instantiate that, and we set the nearest neighbors argument to 5. And then it's as simple as fitting it with the x-train and y-train values. So only that 80% of the data it is now going to use. So this is something that we will use again and again in machine learning. Train test split, make sure everything works well, design the architecture of your model, what goes into it by setting the hyperparameters, and then we just fit the data to that and the learning will take place. Now we've got to talk about, you know, how well this model does. Now fortunately we have 20% of the data that this model has never seen, and we can now feed it to this model of ours. And it can make predictions. And that is with this predict method here. So our trained model, for neighbors, dot predict, and we pass the x test, the feature variables, variable values in our test data set now. And we're going to assign that to a variable called y underscore pred, y prediction. Because we know what the y test values are, the actual values. This is a supervised machine learning. And we can measure the prediction that it makes against the actual values. And so from the metrics module there in scikit-learn, we have this accuracy underscore score function. And what we pass now is the y-test, that's the actual values, and the predicted values from passing the test set. And we get a accuracy back. In this instance, we can see from the test set, our model, very simple model, k-nearest neighbors, very simple architecture, 90% correct. It was 90% accurate on this unseen data. And with classification problems, it's very useful to visualize the results. And we do that with a confusion matrix. And in the metrics module of scikit-learn, there's a plot underscore confusion underscore matrix. So a confusion matrix. So you can also express this as a real matrix, but it's easier just to visualize it. So it's a bit unfortunate, I think, that term confusion, but it stems from the fact that we'll get a very good idea of what it got right, what our model got right, and what it got wrong. So let's plot this and you'll see. So there's a confusion matrix plot. So on the left-hand side, you'll see true label. So label or class, and that would be terms for the sample space elements in our target variable or our dependent variable. So it had 0 and 1 in it. And here's the predicted label or predicted class on the horizontal axis. So if we start here at the 17 at the top, the actual value that we knew from our data set had zeros in it, and the model predicted it to be a 0 in 17 cases. So that would be done quite correctly. Down the diagonal, we see the 19, where the true label was 1, and the predicted label was also 1. So that was done correctly as well. But there was one instance where the true label was 0, but the model predicted it to be 1. So that was obviously wrong. And there were these three cases that the actual label was 1, but the model predicted a 0. So on this diagonal here, that'd be all the mistakes. So let's just play a bit with one important hyperparameter here, and that's the value for k. So what I've set up here now is k equals 3. So I'm reinstantiating the k nearest neighbors classifier, assigning it to the same computer variable. So it's just going to overwrite that. We fit the training data to that. And now we've got a brand new fitted model. And let's do a confusion matrix plot now with k equals 3. And now we see the mistakes have actually gone down. Now there's only two mistakes down here, still the one there. So that's an actual improvement. And if we create a new ypred by calling nay.predict, passing xtest to that, and then using the accuracy score from the metrics module, we're going to see that we now have gone from 90% accuracy to 92.5% accuracy. So you can see how important it becomes to play around with these hyperparameters. And for some architectures like deep neural networks, there are so many hyperparameters, and it becomes a bit of an art to create the best models. So now let's import some data, and that's much closer to real world data. You can find this data set many places on the internet, and that's a bunch of feature variables pertaining to the microscopy of specimens from breast lumps. And those breast lumps has a target variable which indicates whether that observation had a cancerous or non-cancerous lesion. So quite a serious data set. The non-cancerous, those are encoded as a B for benign, meaning it's a non-cancerous growth, and M for malignant, which means it's a cancerous growth. So this data set was downloaded and corrected so that we can use it here. So we have to import it from our Google Drive. So what I'm going to do is use the drive function just to mount my Google Drive and then change directory to this data directory where the CSV file is going to be. So this is going to require me to do that whole procedure with which you are now familiar, and that's to import to at least re-sign up into our account and get that little security code. So after I've done it, we'll rejoin. There we go, we've changed directory with a %cd, so we're in the right directory, and we can now just use the breast_cancer.csv file. As I said, this file is available on the internet. The researchers made this available. So let's have a look at the first five rows using indexing there. And we see there's an ID column. There's a diagnosis, so these would all be cancerous lesions. And then from these specimens, there's a variety of feature variables: the radius mean, the texture mean, the perimeter mean, the area mean, the smoothness mean. So these samples, they were investigated under a microscope, and data on what was seen on these microscope slides were captured in numerical form, and then also in the end, whether the pathologist thought that this was a malignant or benign lesion. So we see the data set there. Let's just call the info method on our data set just to have a look there. And we see the ID is, that's not going to help us because it's a unique ID for every subject. The diagnosis is an object, so that's a categorical variable. M and B is the two sample space elements, and then all of our feature variables here are decimal values, 64-bit floats, and you can see the data set was cleaned up so that there's no missing data here, so that would be quite important as well. So there's also this unnamed colon space 32 column in there, and we've got to get rid of those. So the ID column is not going to help us, because that's just unique to every subject, and that doesn't help us in the machine learning model. And then this unnamed 32 that just came in the way that the file was saved, so we just have to get rid of those. So we use that dataframe.drop method there. We pass as a list the string version of these two column headers. Access one means, you know, these will refer to columns, so drop those two columns. And in place equals true, so it's just going to make the change permanent. And now those two columns are gone. We don't have to worry about this. So remember the next step, we have to look for class imbalance. So let's just look at a bar chart of these, and on the x-axis we'll have the diagnosis column, and we're just going to count how many of the B's and M's are two classes there were. And you can see we have a bit of class imbalance here. A lot more non-cancerous lesions, the B benign lesions, than the malignant lesions. But you can see the numbers here, you know, over 40,000 on the one side and over 100,000 on the other side. Let's just express this as a fraction. So we use the dot value counts method on the df.diagnosis panda series, so on that diagnosis column, and we see 62.7% was benign and 37.3% were malignant. So that would be quite a, I suppose, a bit of an imbalanced data set. It's also interesting in the fact that if we had no model and we said, let's just take the majority class as our prediction. So we said, no matter what the values are, what any new observation is, our model will say it's benign. And we'd be correct in 62.7% of the time. So very importantly, that's our null or our baseline prediction. So a model, a totally naive model, if it just predicted the majority class, was going to be correct a number of times equal to the fraction of that majority class. So we had better build a model that was better than just predicting the majority class. So let's just look at a summary here of all the variables. So that would always be an important thing to do. But what I wanted to really show you is, look at this. This is a very high dimensional problem. We have many feature variables here. So there's no ways for us, obviously, to plot this. Next thing that we could always do is just look for correlation between these, and we can see a correlation matrix there. So every pair of our numerical variables, probably easier just to create a plot of that. It's a bit more visual, but because there's so much data here and we've got so many pairs of feature variables, it takes a little bit, but there we go. So along the main diagonal, we can obviously see that every feature variable is 100% correlated with itself. But you can see here the zero ones are these light colors, and dark blue is absolute positive correlation, and this dark red is absolute negative correlation. So you can see there are some of these features that are correlated to each other. So, you know, that might be a problem. It's obviously a problem when it comes to linear models, but it's just part of the important information that we need along the way when we start building more sophisticated models. So what we want again is just our feature variables on one side and our target variable on the other side. So we're going to create these two computer variables, y lowercase and x uppercase. It's just, you know, sort of standard usage computer variable names. And to y, we're going to assign this df.diagnosis column. And x, we're just going to drop that diagnosis column, because we only want the feature variables in there. So we have our x and our y, exactly what we do. And as before, we're going to do train test split. We've got enough data. We're going to split off 20% of the data as the test set. So you know that we pass our feature variable matrix there, our target vector, the test size is 20%, and random state I've set to 12 here. And we've got to assign that in this order to four computer variables, because this function train underscore test underscore split returns four objects. So we're going to run that cell, and we now can just look at the shape of these and just use the shape attribute. So we see in the training set we have 445 and examples across 30 variables and 114 in the test set. And then Y shape will just have 455, so that equates to that 455 and the 114 to the 114, but it's just a single variable. The next step after our test chain split is to somehow, we're going to use the generic term, normalize the data, although normalization is a specific thing that we do. So it carries both the generic term of what we're doing here, but it's also one of the types. And so one of the types we're going to use here is called standard scaling. So what that does, and it's very important in machine learning, to have all your feature variables in the same similar range, so that you don't have some feature variables that have values in the thousands and others are fractions, 0.4. In many machine learning models, those big numbers are going to dominate when the model starts to learn from the data, and we don't want that. So we scale it all down, and standard scaling brings it all down to a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1, each of our columns. And what it does is it just calculates a z-statistic for every value, and that is how many standard deviations it is away from the mean. So it just takes every column one at a time, calculates for that feature its mean and standard deviation for along all of those values, and it just every value, you just subtract the mean from that and divide by the standard deviation. So you're going to get on the negative side, on the positive side, so that you now have a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So in scikit-learn, there is a class called standard scaler. So once again, we instantiate it, assign it to the computer variable scaler. We set some of the arguments. Copy, we set to true, with mean is true and with standard deviation is true. So it'll know what to do. We have the standard scaler instantiated now, and now we can actually use it. So we're going to overwrite our xtrain values by calling this scaler class of ours, this instantiated class, and we're using the fit underscore transform. So it's going to fit the values, so it's going to do all of those, calculating the mean, subtracting every value, the mean from every value, divided by the standard deviation. So that's what the fit and the underscore transform bit does, because you do get it separately, fit and transform, but you can do it all in one go. Fit transform, it actually changes the value, it overrides what we have there, and we're passing xtrain to that. So let's do that. So we've changed the actual values now. They're no longer what they were when the data was captured, when the original data was captured. All the values are now changed. Now we've got to do the same thing to the test set as well, with a very, very, very important difference. We can't just do the standard scaling on the test set itself. We have to use the parameters of the test set to do the scaling. Very important to do that. So we say scaler.transform. We don't fit this, so we don't calculate for it a mean and a standard deviation. What the actual mean and standard deviation was of each variable in the original actual training data set, we use that mean and that standard deviation to do the change. So you scale by the mean and standard deviation of your training set. You don't do it individually for the test set. That is very important. Otherwise, you're introducing some artifact and unfairness in the way that you're going to do your metrics and perform analysis on how well your model does. So here we use only the dot transform function. We're just transforming it. We're not fitting it. So we're not taking this test set and for each variable calculate its mean and standard deviation in the test set. No, we use that from the training set. So it's just scaler.transform xtest, and we're going to override xtest. And now we can instantiate our classifier, k nearest neighbors classifier. And this time we're going to do 3 nearest neighbors. And we're going to assign that to the computer variable k and n. And all that remains is to fit our feature set and our target set to that. So let's use knn.fit. And we pass those values. And now we have a fitted model. Now we can look at how accurate our model is by considering our test set. So I'm going to use the plot underscore confusion underscore matrix, and we're going to use that function from the matrix module in scikit-learn. I pass my trained model to it, KNN, and then the test set, the features and the target variable for the test set. So we can now see how well our model did. So look at that, not too bad at all. It got 66 benigns correct and got 42 of the actual malignant ones correct. And if it was really benign, it did not misclassify any of them as malignant. But when they were malignant, six of them were classified as benign. So we can use the accuracy underscore score function there from the metrics module, and we pass y test to it. And I didn't save it specifically as a computer variable, the y pred that we did before. So I'm just saying knn.predict given the x test. So this is going to give me the predicted values, and I'm measuring then against the test values, and you can see there the accuracy 94.7%. So all that does is just going to use these four values actually and can calculate the accuracy for us. So let's just have a look at what it did on the training set. So you can actually pass the training set back to it because it's not going to be 100% accurate on the training set, and you don't want it to be, otherwise you're going to have a high variance model. And there is a bit of variance here because 97.8% correct on the training set that it trained from, but only 94.7% as far as the test set that it never seen before. Just want to remind you, there's also the accuracy underscore there that we can use, and that's going to give us the exact same as the just the dot score, the accuracy underscore score. In this instance, it's going to mean the same thing. Now, if you have unbalanced data, there's a whole branch of machine learning that deals with that. Fortunately, what we can do here is we can just use the balanced underscore accuracy score, and that's going to penalize the accuracy of our model a little bit by considering the fact that our classes were imbalanced. So if we do that, which will give us a more, better representation of how the model would do out there in the wild, and that's 93.75, so that's slightly different. Now remember, I had this null score that is, just the majority class, which was 57.9%. So certainly our model is much more accurate than the null model, the null score. So that's a first win for our model. Now the accuracy is just how many it got right divided by how many there were. And that's certainly a good metric, but there are other, and depending on the circumstances, there are other more important metrics. And you can see some of them here. Sensitivity or recall, just depending on the field that you're working in, there are different terms. There's specificity. There's a positive predictor value, or sometimes known as precision, and there's a negative predictor value. Now, we've got to at least understand what those four are because they're very commonly used. Now, in order for us to use them in a classification problem, a binary classification problem more specifically, we have to, as researchers, have interest in one of those two target classes, one of the target labels. That is the one we're interested in, and we're going to assign to that the positive. One of them becomes the positive class, and the other one becomes the negative. Now, it has nothing to do with the human understanding of positive and negative. The positive is just the one that we are interested in studying, and it can be either one of them. So in this instance, and we've got to do that, otherwise we can't use these metrics. Let's assign the positive one to malignant, because we want to know if, this is a test we're doing. There's a biopsy, it gets sliced up, put on a microscope, gets placed under a microscope, and the interest here is whether this is cancerous or not. So naturally, we would choose the cancerous lesion as our positive lesion. So let's do that, and then benign as our negative. And what we can do in many machine learning models is we can say the model is going to predict with a certain probability the positive class and the negative class. And we can set this arbitrary line in the sand, and usually we'll start with a default of 50%. If the probability of the class that is higher than 50%, that's going to turn out to be the prediction that our model makes. We can change that 50% though, depending on the situation, and we usually call that how expensive it is to make an error. If it's very expensive, and expense doesn't only refer to finances, but if it's important to pick up, in this instance, malignant lesions, we might set that bar a little bit lower because then the model will overpredict this to be malignant. And because making that error of calling something benign, non-cancerous, and it is cancerous, is perhaps slightly higher than the cost of predicting the other way around. So we might bring that down, but by default, it's going to be 50%. So let's look at the first actual value in our test set. That was a malignant M. So let's look at what the model predicted. We're just going to say kn.predict and then pass that first set of feature variables, that first row, that first observation. And again, don't worry if you make an error here, if you've got to get to put the reshape, or it must be reshape negative 1 comma 1, 1 comma negative 1, the error message will always tell you and you can just correct that. It's just common to make that little mistake. But you can see it was also malignant. So the model predicted malignant and the actual value was malignant. But remember, this k-nearest neighbors is going to be a majority class. So if some of the nearest neighbors were actually benign as well, but because we chose an odd number, the one is going to win out. But that's purely because we set the 50%, so the highest probability, because most of the neighbors were on one of the other side, that is going to be our prediction. And that gives us these four terms, true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negative. And that it comes by assigning this idea of our research question in assigning one of our classes as the positive class and one as the malignant class. So true positive, you can see in our little table there, an abbreviation is TP. Those would be, if we look at our model here, as far as the confusion matrix is concerned, would be this idea, the 66, the 42, the 0, and the 6. So if malignant was our positive class, then these 42 would be true positives. That means B was our negative class, and it correctly had the 66, so those would be true negatives. Now, the false positive and false negative means a false positive would mean it predicts a positive, but it was actually negative. And the false negative was it predicts negative, but it was actually false positive. So those values, you know, they're really easy, sort of easy to interpret. So let's go down. Let's have this, true positives. Let's set some values there, 42, 66, 0, and 6. True positives, true negatives, false positives, and false negatives. And that allows us to calculate by equation 4 here, these four equations here, the sensitivity or recall, the specificity, the positive predictive value or precision, and the negative predictive value. And you can see the little equations there. So quite easy to calculate. So the sensitivity and specificity, the sensitivity is how many of the actual true ones it predicted as true, because a true positive in real life was a positive and a false negative in real life was also a positive. So how many of those were picked up? Specificity would be how many of the negatives were correctly identified to be negative. So in the denominator, true negatives and false positives, because remember the false positives were actually in real life also negative. So how many of those did it really pick up? The positive and negative predictive values is usually used after the test is done. So once the result comes back positive, you know, what fraction is that? As you can see there, for false positive, for positive predictive values and negative predictive values. And I put just a little sentence in there that you can read. The interpretation of all of these is very dependent on the type of research that you want to do. Just want to also show you there's also an F score, F1 score, I should say, and that is how you calculate the F1 score. And we actually have a metrics.classification underscore report function. If we pass the actual values in our test function and the predicted values in test there, if we, let's just change that back. If we run the cell, it's going to give us a little bit of a report. I wrapped all of that in the as argument and an argument in the print function. We can see the accuracy there, and we can see precision recall and F1 score we can see there. Now I just want to show you this idea of what the model actually does, and that's a probability. So we're going to pass this first 10 observations in our test set, and that's what it's going to be. We used a certain value for k. I think it was k equals 3. So in this instance, in this first one, all three of them were, the nearest neighbors were all malignant. So it was 100% prediction that this would be malignant. But when we come down here, we see 66.67% and 33.33% there. So obviously, two of the three were in the zero class and only one was there. But that's what we say, we use this cutoff of 0.5 so that the majority class always wins. But we can obviously change that. So let's just play with our hyperparameters a bit. And here we're going to use k equals 7. So we instantiate the k nearest neighbors classifier and we set the nearest neighbors to 7. We fit the model with our training data and we look at how accurate it was on the test data, 95.6. So that's actually gone up. So in this instance, k equals 7 was better. So let's have a look just to make sure what it does. Because we have 7, of course, now we divide 100 by 7 so that we get these kind of fractions. So in that first one, all 7 obviously were of the 1 class, and this one it was all of 0 class. And you see those distinctions. We can actually just create a data frame of that and just create a little bar bar chart of that, just to see, you know, the different percentages or probabilities that it was one of the 2 classes. Because that brings us to this idea of a receiver operator characteristic, and that really helps us to decide, you know, where we should draw this line of making, depending on how expensive a mistake might be in either direction, you know, where to do that. And receiver operating characteristic uses false positive rate and true positive rate and thresholds. So there's a metrics.roc underscore curve, and you can see the parameters that we pass to that. And that's what we have here. I want to show you the plot just to explain what's going on. So we've calculated that, and now we can do our plot. So what we have on the x-axis, a bit difficult, that's 1 minus the specificity here. So this 0 would actually be a specificity of 100%, and you know now what specificity is. And we have the sensitivity here on the y-axis. So this dotted line that we see here, that's just the blind guess, 50-50 guess. So you really want your curve to be above that. So if this is 0, which is 1 minus specificity, so this is almost 100% specificity. So by, you know, we don't have to lose a lot of specificity to already jump to 90% in our sensitivity. So, you know, what we actually want is a curve that goes way out here. And, you know, by losing some, depending on what we choose, losing some specificity, you know, starts gaining us on sensitivity, but we don't actually have to do that very much. Our model gets way up here very quickly. And this whole area under the curve is called the area under the receiver operator characteristic curve. And this was from the World Wars, I think World War II, of course, with the radar. And that is to detect the likelihood of picking something up. You know, was this a warplane coming in? Of course, that is not my field. I'm not much of a history buff when it comes to people killing each other, which is a horrible thing. But certainly you can read up on the history of this, the term receiver operator characteristic, the characteristic of these signals that were received in the wartime. So we can actually just do the calculation of that, and a model with a higher score, higher area under the curve, under the ROC curve, the ROC AUC, the higher that is, the better your model is. So one idea comes up, and this is, how lucky were we in determining what the accuracy of our model would be out in the wild? We extracted 20% of the observations at random, but what if we, you know, did this again? And by the random nature would mean 20% other values were extracted. So our model is going to learn from different data, and we're going to use different data for our testing. So we might have been very lucky this time around, or we might do this a couple of times and just report out there, you know, what the best one was. But that's not how it works. We've got to be scientific about this. And one way to do this is just to do this over and over again. And the idea here comes in that is cross-validation. So what cross-validation would do is that we won't split a training and a test set. We'll keep the whole set together. But we're going to set another parameter, and it's then going to divide our data set at random into these number of blocks. And unfortunately, that's also called K. There's something, the term is K-fold cross-validation, and that K has nothing to do with the K and K nearest neighbors. So don't confuse those two Ks. It's K-fold cross-validation. So if we set it to 5, it's going to randomly break our data up into 5 equal sections. And what it's then going to do is going to train this model 7 times over, and every time one of those 5 blocks, now if it's 5 blocks out of 100%, so again that will be 20% of the values will be taken out at random for each of these 5 blocks, it's going to in turn use each of these 5 blocks as its test set. That means we're going to get 5 accuracy scores, and all we're going to do is we can report on the lowest accuracy and the highest accuracy, and also we can average over these, and that's going to give us a better indication, or should give us a better indication of how good our model is going to do there out in the wild. So we have this function cross underscore val underscore score. Now we're going to use this k nearest neighbors with k equals 7 model that we trained. We pass the whole of x and the whole of y, and we have this CV. How many of these blocks do we want to build? So we want to build 5, and the scoring we want to return is the accuracy. So it's going to do that. So it runs this model 7 times. And what we have now is the 5 scores. And we're just going to express the mean score, and you'll see this is going to be slightly down from the high value we got when we built the k equals 7 model. And we can actually look at the minimum and the maximum, and we'll see there's quite a bit of range that, depending on, you know, how lucky we are and what we take out, our accuracy drops down to 87.7 this 5 time and up to 94.7. So it really is very sensitive to that random draw of your test set and your remaining training set. So k-fold cross-validation, when you want to report this in a paper, make use of k-fold cross-validation so that you have a better understanding of how good your model actually is. And then this idea of a grid search for the best hyperparameter values. Fortunately, with scikit-learn, there is this ability to give our model a range of possible values for some of our hyperparameters. And it'll actually run through combinations of these hyperparameters and give us back the best ones. Now, of course, you'll have to do this many times over to get the best ones, but we can do it a couple of times and already have a good idea. Now, every time you run this, you're going to get something different. So what we're going to do is just look at 3 of our hyperparameters that we can set. One was the leaf size. So I'm going to put that between 1 and 50. So say, look through all of those for me and see what the best leaf size is going to be. For the nearest neighbors, we're going to do 1 to 20. And for the p values, we're going to have 1 and 2. So that's our Minkowski difference. Distance, the 2 was just Pythagorean distance, Euclidean distance, and then the 1 is actually just an absolute value distance. So I'm going to set all of that up. So these are the ranges of hyperparameter values for those 3 hyperparameters that I want the search for. And I'm going to build that in as a dictionary with the keys are going to be the actual argument names and then the range of values for each of those, are the values of our key value pairs. So once we've set that, we'll instantiate our k-nearest neighbors classifier once again, and then we're going to use this grid search cross-validation function here. We pass our model to it that we've instantiated, all the hyperparameters that it searches over, and the five-fold cross-validation. So we're going to do all of that. So this is going to take a little bit longer. Wasn't too bad on our Google machine here. And then we can just fit our X and Y and then get back the best values. So that, of course, was just instantiating it. Now it's actually running. And I think every time I run this on Google Colab, it takes about 1.5 minutes because it has to do so many of these sets of hyperparameter values over and over and over again and do cross-validation. So, you know, it's going to take a long, can take a long time depending on the power of your system. So that's 1.5 minutes. So I'll pause the recording here and we'll carry on when that's done. And there we go. And now we can just show what these values are going to be. So we call the best underscore estimator underscore then the get params method. And what we want back is the leaf size. So this is going to be different every time. It says the best leaf size was 1. Let's look at the best nearest neighbors to use. Oh, that was 9. And then the best value as far as our distance metric was concerned, that was 1. So let's use these 191. That's what I got back last time. The previous time when I ran this, it was actually a 991 that it returned. So every time it's going to return something different. So let's just use this 9 nearest neighbors, a leaf size of 9 and a p-value of 1, irrespective of what we had just seen there. But it just shows you how sensitive these are. And so now that we have that, let's do a 5-fold cross-validation. And so let's run that. Yes. And then just print out the mean. And now we can see with that we get to 93.85. So going through all these steps is really important as far as expressing or trying to understand how good your algorithm really is. And when you read papers in the methods section, make sure that your researchers went through all these steps to accurately represent to a fair extent how good their model really is. In this last section, I'm just going to show you what the nearest neighbor regression model looks like. So we're just going to use a small number of just a little bit of toy data just to show you the little bit of difference. It actually works very much the same, so not much that I need to show you, other than for you to understand that our target variable is now a continuous numerical variable. It's no longer different classes. And so let's generate some data. I'm going to set up x values there. And so I only have a single feature variable, and my y, I'm just simply going to calculate twice x. So if we look at our input variable and our output variable here, our features and our target, we see the values there. So let's create a model from this, and we're going to use k equals 3 nearest neighbors, so I can just show you how that works. So instead of k neighbors classifier, we'll have k nearest regressor. Only difference, so we instantiate that architecture there with a neighbor set to 3. And remember x, you'll have to do the reshape, -1,1 in this case. So just be aware of how you have to reshape that. And now we can test our model by putting in a new value. So let's put in 5.5 and see what it predicts. And it predicts a value of 10 on that continuous numerical scale as far as our target variable is concerned. So let's just have a look how it did that. So there we go. There's our feature variables, and there's our brand new variable. And you can see the three neighbors that were closest to it there. So there for our feature variable was 4, there was 5, and there was 6. And all we're going to do is we're going to average over those. So for the three nearest neighbors, we're going to average over that. And that's how we got to 10. Because our values for the target, our actual values was 8, 9, and 10, 8, 10, and 12. And the average of that, those three nearest neighbors, is 10. So the model is going to predict a 10. So it's really as simple as that. So I really hope you enjoyed this lecture. It might be your very first introduction to some machine learning. I chose k-nearest neighbors because it's quite easy to understand, and while it might seem slightly trivial, it actually has very good uses and can be a very powerful algorithm. But it's understandable, and I really wanted to introduce you to all the steps that we go through and expose you to some of the lingo as far as machine learning is concerned, and of course a very exciting field and a very modern approach to understanding your data, bringing that knowledge or story out of your data in a powerful way, in as much as that we can use it for prediction, and also a very different way that we're very, very interested in how accurate our model is by giving it unseen data. Very, very important concept here. And as far at least as these supervised learning models is concerned, you know, something that's imminently usable in real life.